Smino, yeah. The Matinee on the beach, you got it on the heat. Word out in the streets, the girl got the heat. It's on me. I know hitters, I know dealers, I know girls that... Smino is a special artist. With a mix of sounds that take inspiration from some of the greats, like Andre 3000 and Lil Wayne, while still creating a new, futuristic, and fresh neo-soul sound that is unlike any other artist in the game right now. Smino's newest release, Love for Rent, gained him more recognition and turned a year old in October of 2023. His sound on this album was a perfectly refined and beautiful experience from front to back, and it took everything that I'd loved about Smino for years and turned it to 11. So, because I love Smino and I love this album, I wanted to take a deeper dive into Smino's entire discography, his career as a whole, and review each of his albums. If you learned something from this, or you love Smino as much as me, leave a comment, a like, a subscribe, anything. Without further ado, let's start looking at Smino. I know healers, and I really don't feel no difference. We are hustlers, Blu Billy. We condition our conditions, capitalistic,
residualistic. Christopher Smith Jr., aka Smino, a loud and proud St. Louis rapper, actually got his career beginnings in Chicago. He attended the Columbia College of Chicago to study media and management, where he wanted to learn the business of music. He came from a long line of musicians, which inspired his work from the beginning. His father, a piano player, his mother, a singer, and his grandfather was a bassist for the famed Muddy Waters. However, one of his biggest inspirations was his cousin, Dre Smith, who helped Smino get on the path of hip-hop and rap, especially during his college years. These years at Columbia truly kickstarted Smino's career. He released 3 mixtapes with his friend and fellow artist Bari, who was an instrumental part of Smino's beginnings as an artist. He also met his current manager, Chris Innumerable, better known as Chris Classic. From the years of 2009 to 2013, Smino would go under the name C-Sme, and typically perform and release mixtapes under the name Young, Dumb, and Out of Control, or YDOC, which was his duo with Bari. While a lot of this work has been lost to time, some of the tracks can still be found online through great sources like the Smino subreddit or the YouTube channel Velvet Vault, and of course the old C-Sme YouTube channel itself. Along with these YDOC mixtapes, another mixtape that is a little harder to find is his collaboration tape with Bari called Retail, which was supposedly released in 2013. If you're looking for the download link, once again, I would shout out the Smino subreddit. His first official mixtape under his name Chris Smith Jr. was Smeezy.com. Releasing in the middle of YDOC and Retail, Smeezy.com is not exactly a must listen if you're going through Smino's catalog. Definitely a showcase of how far Smino has come. Smeezy.com fits the mixtape vibe with some weirdly out of character beats and some shaky rapping, but the occasional fun bar here and there. And after this mixtape, it seems like Smino focused more on the internet crowd as well as SoundCloud. He would start dropping not only under the Chris Smith Jr. name, but also on Smeezy.com, which he would release some beats that he had created himself. Eventually, around 2014, he would transition to the Smino name. His first song, From the Mountains, is a little more familiar to listeners like me who got started with Black Swan, as this features a more laid-back and classic Monte Booker beat. The connection between Monte Booker and Smino is absolutely classic, and this is really where it begins. Honestly, without Monte Booker, there would be no Smino at this point. Monte's production style mixes so perfectly with Smino's outlandish flows, it's just a classic connection. He would eventually go on to drop more songs in 2014, but the most important thing was not an album or a song at all. This year would mark the formation of Smino's independent record label, Zero Fatigue. Zero Fatigue's roots were there since Smino was in college, as some of the founding members alongside him were Bari and Classic, but this group also brought in the likes of Monte Booker, Raven Lanay, Groove, J2, and others, with Monte and Raven being the two most important in Smino's journey. So now, as 2014 was wrapping up, Smino's career was getting to a more familiar spot for listeners like me. Now is the time we can start looking deeper into Smino's projects. While all of Smino's older material wasn't the most inspired, it seems like he left a lot of that style behind, but the one thing he did keep is his love of mixtapes. Smino has always been an artist that just drops an EP, a few singles, or a random mixtape here and there. This gives his music such an underground vibe that a lot of hardcore hip-hop listeners can't get enough of. His transition to SoundCloud in 2014 really accented that feeling, and gained Smino this reputation. This was certainly the case in 2015, where Smino dropped two EPs, Sick 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 and Black Jupiter. Sick 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 released on October 2nd, 2015, with three songs, and I think this is truly where Smino got his style figured out. This EP worked as a great reintroduction to Smino, just short enough to make every song count, but diverse enough to really get a feel for him. Ruby Red was one of the first Smino songs I have ever heard, and I think it was an excellent introduction. Maybe it's my nostalgia speaking, but this is still one of my favorite songs from him to this day. The slow intro, the slightly different vocals from Smino, the synths as the beat kicks into gear, the singing and flow on the hook, excellent start. Ballet was an intro to the more high-energy Smino cuts, kind of calling back to the old days of See Smee with the high-energy collaboration with Bari. Not really one of my favorites from Smino, but a good song nonetheless. And Raw feels like a prelude to Blkswn. The sound palette is definitely similar. The classic call and response Smino with a bit of distortion makes an appearance here, but the whole song feels just like that. Build up for what's to come later. Overall though, this was a solid EP as a whole. It definitely felt like a great taste of what makes Smino so unique, without fully delving into the full story. Moving on though, releasing on December 11th of 2015, then re-releasing for all streaming platforms on June 3rd, 2016, Smino's Black Jupiter is exactly what it sounds like, from a different world. Smino's intent, as he says in an interview with Ear Milk, is to showcase his differences, to describe how he feels alien compared to others. "I swear to God, if I go out into the world by myself," he says, "I feel like a whole ass alien. Most people are on some systematic going to work shit, but the art world is pretty much like alienating ourselves." I think this is an interesting statement, how Smino feels like he is an outsider for just expressing himself, for being an artist. It really puts into perspective his entire career. If you, like many, started listening to Smino with Blkswn, these sounds from Black Jupiter may sound very familiar. However, I think the way Smino is a little more raw, a little more laid back, and a little more experimental on Black Jupiter is what makes the EP feel special. Black Jupiter's first track, the title track, feels a bit hollow while putting some more focus on Smino's rapping, which we all know to be excellent. He continues switching flows and sounds confident and fun while doing it. Even if it's not a favorite of mine, there's still no doubt that this is an iconic Smino track for a lot of fans, as he's performed it forever. Following up with Zoom, the beat is definitely unusual right off the bat. It reminds me of one of his bigger hits in Z4L, with its plinky sample in the background. His rapping is a highlight once again here, but his singing as we round out the track is also very good. The track Runnin', featuring a Zero Fatigue classic collaborator J2, is why so many people love the Zero Fatigue group. The chemistry between these two, the beat, and their rapping ability is just unparalleled. Definitely a standout track. Getting into Papa with Julian Bell, the neo-soul beat mixed with Smino's fast-paced rapping and Julian Bell on the hook make this another amazing track and one of Smino's deeper cuts. Rounding out the track list with Oxygen, the EP finishes off strong with another hollow neo-soul beat that focuses more on Smino's singing. Doesn't really do too much to stand out from Smino's discography, but there is no bad Smino song. After these two EPs, Smino would continue to drop a few loosies here and there. 2016 saw him feature on some other highly respected artists, with a feature on No Name's iconic Telephone album, and another slept on classic with the feature on Saba's Bucket List project. This trio of artists would eventually become Ghetto Sage. After these features, however, fans were left to wait until 2017 for his first official album. Smino's first studio album, and first ever studio album under the Zero Fatigue label, Blkswn, seems to be a follow-up to Black Jupiter. However, I feel as if this album takes a completely different direction and a larger step forward. While Jupiter is focused more on outlandish sounds and Smino's rapping ability, Blkswn is able to balance his love of unusual flows, his R&B-esque melodies, and create an atmosphere unlike anything else he's made thus far. While you may argue this is exactly what made Smino so popular in general, the way he refined himself on Black Swan is why this album feels like a new experience from Smino. In fact, I feel that this is where Smino defined himself, period. Sure, we got a taste of what we liked about him from his EPs and features, but this was really his breakout. The first single to release was the title track Black Swan, releasing at the end of 2016, followed by Anita 2 months later. Both of these songs certainly deserved to be singles, as they really told the whole vibe of the album and were great songs on their own. Afterwards, Black Scars and Father Son Holy Smoke would also release as singles in February and March respectively. Finally, in 2017, the album released on 314, the area code of St. Louis. Despite not releasing to too much buzz, the album was definitely a breakout for Smino. The publications who did give it time when it first came out gave it some high praise, and Smino was even named New Artist of the Week by Apple Music. Eventually, as the year went on, Black Swan would start to get its flowers, ending 6th on BET's 10 Best Albums of 2017, 18 on Rolling Stone's 40 Best Rap Albums, and 41 out of 50 on Complex's Best Albums of 2017. While there's not too much information on the artistic process behind the artwork, I do find it to be a very fitting piece of art for the sound of the album. The mix of black along with the purples and reds mix together to create a slow and dreary atmosphere, all surrounding Smino getting his hair done. As you should know, hair is a big part of Smino's persona, a tool of expression for him, so making it the focal point of his first studio album is no coincidence. The title of the album, Black Swan, is assumedly evoking the whole ugly duckling turning into a swan story. This would fit well with the themes of feeling like an alien on Black Jupiter, but instead of feeling alienated, growing from his outsider status, embracing what's special about him, and blossoming into a swan. The album itself is a mix of everything we know Smino to be now. The relaxed, laid-back, borderline druggy beats, the high-energy tracks with sporadic flows, the neo-soul crooning throughout. There is not a single track here that feels like it harkens back to the days of See Sme. However, Black Swan definitely feels like a culmination of everything he's done to this point, just finally broken out of its shell that's been developing since 2009. Every song but the title track, Father Son Holy Smoke, was produced by Monte Booker, further establishing their connection and also establishing a consistent sound palette for the album. The opening track for the album, Wild Irish Roses, is one of the best laid-back Smino tracks to this date. The drugged-out, warping synths to introduce the track before getting mixed with the slow, trap-inspired beat really sets the mood. When I think of this album, this is the song I think of first. It sounds like the feeling the album cover is meant to convey, especially when it accompanies the music video. An excellent opening track. Maraca keeps a laid-back beat, but Smino's energy and bars here about how he can make the crowd shake keep this song memorable. The next song, Glass Flows, is a standout for the album, being the first collaboration between just Raven Lenae and Smino. The beat on this track, with its reversed and spacey synth sounds, mixed with the wild tapping in the background, is just as trippy as the opening track. Raven's vocals are the highlight to me. Her verses and the spot on the chorus are wonderful. Keeping the run of great tracks going, the next song is another Zero Fatigue collaboration with Flea Flicker. This track sees the classic duo of Bari and Smino linking up again. You can feel the chemistry between them here, Bari's verse sliding perfectly on this track. And the next track is just as strong with Spitshine, another of my personal favorites for nostalgic reasons. The beat on here is so simple yet works so well. It keeps Smino flowing with his fun delivery where it sounds like he's going down a slide at a playground. Another great and super fun track. Netflix and Duce is the pinnacle of Netflix and chill. It's sexy, it's fun, it's catchy. What's there not to love about this track? Anita is again another standout from the album. A similar case to Maraca, where the beat is more laid back and simple, while Smino's energy is the star of the track. The delivery of the chorus is obviously the highlight here, but Smino's flow on his first verse in particular is excellent. A Smino classic for a reason. Lobby Call feels like an interlude, but that's not a negative at all. The beat is something else, with its almost wheezy instrumentation. And this song almost feels like a callback to the sound that was being crafted on the two EPs before the album. Edgar Allan Poe'd Up, featuring The Mind, a producer and songwriter from the classic studio crowd, is another fun track. The warbly beat fits perfectly well on this album, and the singing to close out the track may get a little repetitive, but it is still fun nonetheless. Father Son Holy Smoke is a track where Smino gets to showcase his rapping ability. His classic double entendre bars and witty wordplay are in full effect here. B-Roll is honestly one of the more forgettable tracks here in my opinion. I of course love the beat and Smino's delivery as usual, but it doesn't all blend together too well. However, the rapping on the second verse is excellent. Black Scars sonically blends perfectly from the last track. Featuring J2, the track lets the themes of the albums really shine through. J2's first verse and his hook introduce the theme of how the black community has been accomplishing so much, but have just now gotten the chance to show it off. The rest of the track, Smino goes further into the themes of black excellence. A great track. Thematically, Black Scars blends well into the next track, the title track, Black Swan. This is where Smino takes the theme of black excellence and uses it to flex his own personal accomplishments. The beat and the rapping here are, of course, excellent as always, and it is definitely a highlight for the album. Continuing with the thematically important tracks, Long Run focuses on Smino's upbringing and how it influenced him, both good and bad. He also talks about the challenges he faced, how he felt like he had to suppress his true self to be successful, and how he has now had the opportunity to showcase himself. He also talks about how the murder rate in the area he grew up in was also being suppressed, as if trying to hide the ugly truths, and how this can negatively impact someone growing up. This creates an interesting parallel between his two verses. A great track. Next we get into Intermission, which is a more lighthearted rapping track. The beat here is repetitive yet fast-paced, but the pace is still overtaken in speed by Smino's rapping. Silk Pillows, featuring Chicago native Akenya, is what Smino does best, a smooth, sexy track. Smino's classic swagger is just all over this track, and it makes it one of the more slept-on feel-good tracks in his discography. The Silk Pillow name would eventually also be used for Smino's line of hoodies. Ricky Millions, featuring Smino's cousin Dre Smith, talks about how he feels like the black community is being trapped. From the chorus, it seems like he may feel as if it may be wrong for him to have this success while he leaves others from his community behind. Smino also calls back to Stevie Wonder's Isn't She Lovely with a melodic interpolation at the end. Overall, this second to last track was pretty good. And finally, we get to the behemoth Amphetamine. Technically, the track is split into two. After the beat switch, the second half is entitled Crash Course, featuring No Name, John Doe, and Bari. This is my personal favorite Smino track, and one of my favorite songs of all time. The first half's drowsy beat makes this a quintessential drug anthem, where Smino raps about his drug use and his hope that it improves. Then the second half Crash Course starts out with a Smino verse full of some great double entendres. He talks about the appropriation of black culture, how it's been built up by the greats like his grandfather or Chuck Berry, but being misrepresented by those who try to take advantage of the culture. Bari's chorus is a great part of this track. The delivery on the first line is so catchy. John Doe's verse is great too, with some very clever rhyme schemes and fun flows. And then the No Name verse to finish it all off keeps the same energy, with the same amazing pen game that was all over Telephone. Amphetamine and its second half is an absolute classic, easily my favorite Smino track of all time, and if there's one thing you take away from this video, it should be to listen to this song. Overall, Black Swan is a classic in whatever genre you decide to attribute it to. It gave Smino some major momentum in his career. It brought some amazing tracks like Wild Irish Roses, Glass Flows, and Amphetamine. And after almost 7 years, this album still sounds brand new and innovative in the genre. A definite gem. After this album, Smino would begin his tour, the Swanita Tour, open up for SZA's Control Tour alongside Rave and Lene, and open for T-Pain on his acoustic tour. All this hype led fans to wonder what was next for Smino. Luckily, fans would only have to wait about a year and a half to hear Smino's next studio album. When When it comes to noir, it's hard to look at between the cohesive and monstrous efforts of Black Swan and Love for Rent. It gives off more of a mixtape vibe when you compare it to these two, as it doesn't really follow as consistent of a sound palette or come in with any really major themes or goals like the other records. However, it does feel like the quintessential sophomore album. What noir lacks in cohesion, it makes up for it with fun. Fun beats, fun rapping, fun bars, fun flows, just everything is fun about it. Releasing on November 8th, 2018, Noir released to more fanfare than Black Swan. With generally positive reviews from some bigger publications, Noir re-established Smino and brought him more into the mainstream. This was also Smino's first time appearing on the Billboard Top 200, debuting at number 191. The album's cover features Smino once again getting his hair done. This time we're seeing it from the perspective of a television, which goes with the theme of movies with this album. We see a stack of VHS on the table, we're seeing Smino watch a movie, and the title itself refers to the noir genre. Smino himself stated this theme in a Twitter post. This goes hand in hand with not only the themes that Smino pushes throughout his music, but the fact that Smino is just having a more lighthearted and fun time with this record. Smino on noir tries out some new styles, some more varied beats, keeps the energy high throughout the record, but that's not to say he tones down his typical swagger on this album, as there are cuts as smooth as ever like MF Groove and the track Hoopty. I just love how expressive Smino allows himself to be on this album, reassuring his status as the fun-loving, stylish, and fresh rapper that he is. Looking at the album, the first track Covert starts out with John Doe, who appeared on Black Swan, essentially whispering about the album title. She says four words that describe the energy of the album perfectly: black, statuesque, strong, and sweet. The track itself is a great intro, starting with a more muted beat to get Smino flowing as soon as possible. The way he almost whispers his second verse is so great and so smooth. The next track, LMF, or Lion Mufasa, has got to be one of my favorite beats on the album. I don't have too much to say about the song itself, as it's hard to describe the flow Smino comes through with on this track without just hearing it for yourself. This was the first of the singles released for Noir prior to release, and it definitely deserved that spot. Seriously, one of the more slept-on tracks in Smino's whole discography. Insane flow. Next is Clink, the second single released before Noir. This track is all about Smino's delivery. It just shows how much fun Noir is. And again, if you heard it, you know exactly what I'm talking about. This is one of Smino's bigger hits in general, and it holds up so well. Hilariously fun track. Tequila Mockingbird again describes the fun of this album, however, I don't think it stands out as much as Clink. Something about it just feels a little too gimmicky for me, so I don't really revisit it all too often. But when I listen to the album altogether, I always find myself grooving to that rhythm along with Smino. Spins is a bit more laid back than the first four tracks. Smino's delivery on the beginning of his first verse is excellent and smooth as ever. The beat and especially the chorus feel like you're recovering from the part of a wild party by just sitting back and having a smoke. Such a comforting and chill track, one of my favorites. Speaking of chill, Somersault with Bari is coming through with the same vibe. These two never disappoint together, and this song is no exception. The flows are so smooth, they slide through the drowsy beat so well. Z4L, or Zero for Life, is of course about the connection between Zero Fatigue. Also featuring Bari along with J2, this is definitely a standout track. Another one of Smino's bigger hits, everything is on 10 on this track. Everyone's deliveries through the track are so great. The refrain from Bari, no matter how short, always cuts right through. J2's verse was great as well, matching Smino's energy perfectly. Another great, great track. However, the next track, Merlot, never really hit as hard for me. Coming back to this track for the first time in a while for this video, I found myself really appreciating the beat and the flow throughout the track. However, I just feel as if Smino comes through with similar sounds and does them a bit better on other tracks, so maybe that's why I don't get as much from this track. We Got the Biscuits, with some almost rage-like sounds in the background, is another track I came in appreciating more after not hearing it for a while. I do always like when Smino tries out some newer sounds, and this was a great effort, but again, just doesn't hit for me personally. The last minute or so, though, is great. Hoopty is such a vibe. when the trap-like beat comes in after the piano intro, the track just reaches another level. This is what makes Smino so likable. The way he just flows so effortlessly on any beat, no matter how many times it changes through only 2.5 minutes. Paisano is classic Smino. Something about this track specifically is so nostalgic to me. Maybe it's the energy, maybe the hi-hats throughout remind me of SoundCloud era, maybe it's that chorus, I don't know. Whatever it is, it just screams classic Smino to me. Low Down Dirty Blues is so smooth it's almost dangerous. The beat is phenomenal. Monte Booker is a pure genius. Fenty Sex is my personal favorite on the whole album. The beat is perfect, but as Smino starts to really get going, it somehow gets better. The way Smino flows through this track is just plain perfect. The verse from Chicago rapper Dreezy brings the same energy. It's just such a smooth track and will forever be slept on. Skeetos is a track where Smino tries something a little off the wall that definitely does pay off. This track has such an unusual chorus, but it's just so fun. The beat helps the silly flow along, and it keeps it memorable and honestly pretty catchy. MF Groove is another one of my personal favorites. Featuring the fabulous Raven Lane, the wheezy beat is so groovy, especially with Smino's distant vocals. It feels like such a trip, and calls back a lot to the same energy as their previous collaboration, Glass Flows. Supposedly, Smino produced this track himself, which in that case, give the man his flowers. Definitely the best beat on the album, and easily one of the best tracks as a whole. And finally, Verizon finishes off the album on a slower note. I love the delivery of the chorus on this track, but not too much stands out, especially for this being the outro. When you have tracks like Lee and Lovey and Amphetamine to battle with for the spot of best Smino outro, there's definitely a reason Verizon isn't talked about as much. Overall, despite its inconsistency, Noir is exactly what Smino fans would want more of. It's a bit all over the place, with some of Smino's most accessible and well-known tracks, but some of his deeper cuts and more unconventional tracks on here too. While it's personally not my favorite Smino album, there's no way I could ever call this anything less than great. After Noir, Smino would go on another tour, this time accompanied by Earthgang and Felix. Unfortunately, between the gap of these two albums, Bari would leave Zero Fatigue, citing exploring his possibilities as the main reason. It was definitely sad to see Bari leave Zero Fatigue, especially considering he was one of the founding members. However, Smino continued on with Zero Fatigue, and continued exploring his own possibilities, especially during the 4-year gap between Noir and his next album. Leading up to Love for Rent, we got a long hiatus between studio records, but no shortage of music. Smino went more into a feature artist role, finding himself work more heavily around artists in the Dreamville sphere like Earthgang and Jid, and of course featuring heavily on their collaborative record, Revenge of the Dreamers 3. His closeness with Jid would not just be a one-off venture, as he would form a group known as Zoink Gang with Jid, Guapdad 4000, and Buddy, as well as even going on a tour with Jid entitled Love Forever throughout 2023. Speaking of groups, before Love for Rent is also the formation of Ghetto Sage, another group with some like-minded common collaborators like Saba and No Name, two artists which you should also be very familiar with if you're a fan of the Dreamville sphere and sounds like Smino. At the end of 2021, Smino signed with Motown for a record deal that we don't know the details of yet. Either way, this is a big step up from Interscope in terms of reach. Smino wasn't just working on features, deals, and supergroups though, as he dropped many singles, a color show, and a mixtape off major streaming services titled She Already Decided. All the songs on this mixtape featured a pretty similar sound, focusing more stripped back, psychedelic, and simple beats to focus more on flows and rapping. I feel like this mixtape was a perfect holdover between records, as it kind of mixed together the sounds we'd see later with Love for Rent, and the sounds previously from Noir and Black Swan. It was also more sample heavy than his previous work, featuring freestyles over some iconic beats like Baby Keem's Orange Soda and Roddy Ricch's The Box. It's unfortunately unlikely that we'll ever see the full mixtape on major streaming services. However, the mixtape was a lot of fun and featured some of that iconic Smino charm. Some standouts for me are the intro Fronto Isley and Cotton Candy. After 2 more years from this mixtape, Love for Rent finally dropped on October 28th, 2022 under Motown and Zero Fatigue. If there's one word I can use to describe Love for Rent, it is addicting. This album is like musical crack to me. The first time I listened to it, I admit that I wasn't immediately hooked. I found myself gravitating to the songs that sounded like his previous work, like cuts like Ol' Ass Kendrick and Pudgy with Lil Uzi. Of course, the two singles that dropped, Matinee and 90 Proof, were absolutely excellent, but upon first listen, I didn't really connect with them. As I listened more and more, I got sucked into the world of Love for Rent, appreciating it as a completely different beast from most of Smino's previous work, despite it being so similar. Love for Rent is, unsurprisingly, about love. It's about self-love, loving your family, loving a significant other, and how love changes a person. As Smino said himself, it's all about love and how you can use and lose your heart in the process. The album's cover reflects this theme even further, featuring him and several others doing their hair. As Smino said in an interview with Complex, I wanted to show that I'm doing my own hair on this cover because I'm supposed to represent self-care and self-love. I always had someone else taking care of my shit, or may have been putting my crown in the hands of other people. But I can take care of my crown too. Self-love is definitely a big theme on this album. And I also think another way to interpret it is I was leading other people to self-love too. I feel as if this harkens back to the cover of Black Swan for similar reasons. Smino is also known to have very expressive hairstyles, so I think the theme of hair and doing one's hair is a really great way to symbolize self-expression, self-love, and intimacy. Smino's love for samples from the Sad mixtape shine through on this album, as it was the first with some major samples. The track Pro Freak shone through with some upbeat sampling, keeping the hyper tempo up, while a track like No L's featured sampling in the background as an environment builder. Most of the album was, of course, produced by the fabulous Monte Booker, and it experimented with his sounds further than on Smino's previous work. The feel of this album is unlike any other from Smino, and probably unlike any artist, period. The expertly interwoven tracklist mixed with the laid-back neo-soul slash neo-funk vibe through the whole album is really building an interesting vibe. Starting with the intro from The Source, we get a beautiful beginning into the world of Love for Rent, introducing the themes of family and love. Referencing his cousin who passed, the song also features some distant sounds in the background and a voicemail. This theme of phone calls and voicemails from family members and others comes through the entire album and ties the themes together. It always has something to do with love, which, again, is just the major theme of this album. We are immediately shot into the thrilling three-track run of No L's, 90 Proof, and Pro Freak. Some of Smino's best work in my opinion, and definitely his best and most consistent three-track run in all of his discography. No L's is my personal favorite of the three. So catchy, the flow is perfect, and his wordplay is hilarious yet contemplative. Smino talks about setting up his future generations with his iconic delivery over the same sample as Tyler and Rocky's Potato Salad. 90 Proof is just a solid Smino banger, featuring a great verse from J. Cole. This song keeps the momentum going, and builds on it from No L's, and then perfectly transitions into the next track, Pro Freak. Pro Freak features a verse from Dochi where she absolutely goes off. Another certified banger that acts as the climax and resolution for the momentum built in this three-track run, ending with a beat switch that essentially sets up the rest of the album. The first three tracks are probably the most different out of the entire album, as the middle of this album settles into a similar and beautiful vibe. Old Ass Kendrick is a classic Smino track, with a psychedelic Monte Booker beat and some great flow and wordplay from Smino. I especially like the chorus on this track. Luphoria features a hypnotic and bouncy beat, another beat that just perfectly describes why Smino and Monte work together so well, creating a perfect vibe that kind of sucks you in and won't spit you out. A great centerpiece for the album, yet it works as sort of an interlude that flows perfectly into Blu Billy. If Luphoria was a druggy, hypnotic, and entrancing song, Blu Billy is a song that makes you feel like you're picking yourself up and striving for success. Which makes sense, as this song is Smino celebrating himself, yet not separating himself from any of the other common hustlers that you see through the world. Drug dealers, people simply driven by money. I like this as the message for the song. Smino being prideful while still being humble, flexing his success yet not putting himself on a pedestal, showing his hustle while not claiming he's better than anyone else. Matinee might be the best track on this record. In context of just a single, it really didn't click with me, but together with the entire record surrounding it, Matinee is such a powerful track. really leaning into the message of self-love with this track. It just really feels like a party. The central bar of, I know this whole world's just a matinee, so just put down your mask and hit this gas with me, highlights the themes of this album of just letting go of your worries, relaxing, and being unapologetically yourself. This theme that Smino has explored for this entire album and his entire discography as a whole, being sung so beautifully over this hyperactive and entrancing beat, really makes this track work so much better with the context of the album. More Than a Minute slows down the tempo and changes the focus to Smino's love life, specifically focusing on just one woman. A pretty and lush track to transition us to the latter half of this album, which focuses more on love and relationships. Speaking of which, going into the beautiful defibrillator, we're met with one of the best vocals that Smino has ever delivered. This whole album is just full of tugs on the heartstrings, and this song is probably the peak of that. The beat is from Groove, who produced such songs as Jid's 2007, Sacrifices, and 90 Proof on this album. Groove's sound does not disappoint, meshing beautifully with Smino's vocals to create my favorite song on the album. Garden Lady acts as another interlude type track, focusing more on the vibe and environment of the song rather than any important messages. This song feels like anxiety poking through a drug-fueled breakup recovery, and I think that works well within the context of this half of the album. Speaking of anxieties, getting to settle down, Smino raps about all of the things that he could have missed out on his life had things gone differently. This is then met with dismissal, as Smino leaves it all up to God and realizes he needs to settle down. I love this song, the energy is infectious, and I love Raven Lanae's vocals throughout. Pudgy features one of the least talked about Lil Uzi verses of all time. I love the flows throughout this track from both Smino and Uzi, and I think it keeps the energy going from Settle Down before abruptly ending with the transition to the penultimate song, Curtains. Another of my favorites. This song talks about Smino's successes, how he will keep growing, and calls back to the beginning of the album by reprising from the source, making this feel like the curtain call of the album. The air of finality of this song gives it a really sweet, laid back, and reflective vibe. However, just because it feels like the last song doesn't mean it is, as the final track, Lee and Lovey, is not to be slept on. The song featuring Reggie is just downright beautiful. This song is about love, a long-lasting relationship, genuine and full love. The title is in reference to his grandfather, Lee Smith, and his wife, Lovey, perfectly tying up and dedicating the album and the themes of love to Smino's grandparents. Overall, this album is full of energetic moments, sullen lows, moments of drug-fueled reflection, and love. Critically and commercially, this was Smino's most successful album. While diehard fans might say Black Swan is his best, I think Love for Rent brings such a complete package, both sonically and thematically, that I find it to be his best work. If this is the direction Smino is going, I think that he will only continue to get better. As for now, Smino has no plans for another album anytime soon. While he has mentioned the deluxe for Love for Rent once in an offhand tweet, and the mixtape Sad 2 was supposed to drop in 2023, now rumored to drop this April, no major plans for another major studio album release is on its way. As an addendum, as soon as I finished editing like 70% of this video, Smino announced that he plans on releasing 3 albums this year. One can assume that Sad 2 is one of them, maybe a deluxe for Love for Rent is another. Rumors have also been circulating throughout the year that a Ghetto Sage album is in the works, or will be this year. As of right now, it's all up in the air, but I'm excited nonetheless. Smino wrapped up his yearly Cribmas performance in St. Louis in December of 2023, and he finished his duo tour with Jid in March of 2023. Smino's diverse and unique library makes him unlike any other artist in the game right now. I can think of no other artists besides Smino that are so talented, yet not talked about nearly on the same level as the other artists who are doing neo-soul, R&B, hip-hop, whatever you want to call Smino's music. His discography more than deserved a deeper look. I don't talk for however long I did out of anything other than love for his art, his style, and everything about the guy. In no way am I trying to take away from the experience of listening to his albums or objectively rank his discography. I'm not trying to make him seem lame by over-explaining his every move. In fact, I ranted about Smino for so long to encourage you to give your own talking points and experiences with his music. The one thing I want this channel to be is an outlet for me and anyone else who loves music as much as me to be able to discuss the artists they love. If there's one thing you do take away from this video, it's to just listen to more Smino, and to more art in general. Thank you so much for watching. Hey, thanks again for watching. I know it's taken a while for this video to come out. I am back in school, so it takes a little more time to find the time to do some videos, but I do want to spend a little more energy on it. It's just a good outlet for me, and I have fun doing it, you know. I wanted to do a Smino video for a while. I really like Smino on the same level as I like something like Mac. Great artist, and a lot of people don't talk about him enough, so I wanted to kind of have a video where a lot of people can share their experiences, and I can talk a lot about how I feel about Smino's music and kind of learn more about his whole upbringing, I guess. But yeah, thanks again for watching. I'll still be working on videos, so yeah, just share your favorite Smino experiences or something in the comments. Tell me if there's any kind of video you want me to take a look at. Yeah, thanks again for watching, though.